You're listening to the audio production of The Surprising Rebirth of Belief in God, Why New Atheism Grew Old and Secular Thinkers Are Considering Christianity Again, by Justin Brierley, published by Tyndale Elevate. This book is read by the author. To Lucy, there's no one I'd rather share this adventure with. Foreword by the Right Reverend Professor N.T. Wright, Senior Research Fellow, Wycliffe Hall, University of Oxford. The book you are listening to uses, as its central metaphor, Matthew Arnold's poem, Dover Beach, and the long withdrawing roar of the Sea of Faith. That was Arnold's perception of the 19th century phenomenon in which many Europeans simply stopped believing the Christian message. Some years ago, I wrote an Emmaus Road-style parable that invoked the same poem, but this time moving in the opposite direction. I imagined two serious-minded unbelievers walking home together, puzzling out how to make sense of the world towards the end of the 20th century. Modernity's Enlightenment dream of progress had run out of steam. Postmodernity's questioning of values, power, and identity had blown the whistle on the secular world they had come to take for granted. As this pair walked along the road to Dover Beach, they discussed how this had come to be. Why had they been let down by the stories by which they once lived? How should they now inhabit a world where their dreams had gone sour, a culture where they didn't even know who they were anymore? Into this conversation came Jesus, incognito. "Foolish ones," he replied, "how slow of heart you are to believe all that the Creator God has said." And as they walked together, he showed them, beginning with Moses, then the prophets and apostles of the New Testament as well, how, through the story of Scripture and its culmination in the life, death, and resurrection of one person, God had acted in the world to create a new humanity. This person's identity transcended all other identities. His story redefined all other stories. My version of the parable saw Jesus and the two travellers finally arriving at Dover Beach. On the shore stood a vast and hungry crowd. Modernism had caused the Sea of Faith to retreat, but the tide was now rolling back in. Yet, having scattered their bread upon the water, all that the incoming tide of postmodernity brought them was bricks and centipedes, proving G.K. Chesterton's dictum that when people stop believing in God, they do not believe in nothing. They believe in anything. That, I suggested, was the dilemma facing the serious secularist in the last decades of the last century. Happily, Justin Brierley is more hopeful now than I was then about what the returning Sea of Faith might bring in its wake. In this book, he describes how, despite the decline in church membership, attitudes towards Christianity among serious thinkers in many fields seem to be changing. Having interviewed many of the key players over many years, Justin offers a sharply drawn, enticing picture of the way public discussion of Christian faith has swung round to the point where the once fashionable atheism has itself begun to look suspiciously threadbare. In recent years, Justin and I have regularly conversed about these issues on the podcasts he hosts, and I've been a glad participant in some of the conversations with public thinkers that are referred to in these chapters. I am encouraged that so many of these thinkers seem disenchanted with secularism's empty promises, and that, for many, the residual memory of Christianity still holds a wistful appeal. Interestingly, those of their number who find themselves attracted to the church are rarely looking for a spiritualized version of the current moral zeitgeist. What's attractive about the faith is precisely its countercultural stance, the weirdness of believing and living as if Jesus really has risen from the dead and is calling those who follow him to live a different story to the world around them. G.K. Chesterton also said, "Christianity has died many times and risen again, for it had a God who knew the way out of the grave." What if the Christian story is poised to come rushing back into public consciousness in our day? Could it once again nourish the hearts and minds of people who have been starved of meaning and purpose for so long? Like Justin, I hope so. perhaps we are indeed seeing the early signs of such a returning tide. My parable ended with the two travellers wearily opening a small picnic basket, totally inadequate for the task of feeding so many hungry people standing on the shore. Gently, Jesus takes the basket from them, and in what seems like moments, everybody on the beach is fed. Then the eyes of everyone are opened, and they realize who he is. He then vanishes from their sight. Whatever the returning tide looks like, the task of Christians in a postmodern world is to be the re-embodiment of Jesus. We are tasked with bringing food to the hungry on the shores of the Sea of Faith. We are to tell the story of the Creator and his world and his victory over evil to any serious-minded unbelievers who will listen. Do such people exist? This book should persuade you that they do, that people who presently do not believe in the Christian worldview or in its central figure and his victory over evil and death are indeed ready to listen again. This is, after all, a real story. It is centered upon a real figure, a real hero, and it still has the power to change the world. Introduction. The Sea of Faith was once too at the full and round earth's shore, lay like the folds of a bright girdle furled, but now I only hear its melancholy, long, withdrawing roar. Matthew Arnold, Dover Beach. When the Victorian poet Matthew Arnold published his famous poem, Dover Beach, in 1867, it served as a eulogy for the certainties of a bygone era, especially religion. 100 years earlier, the Enlightenment had swept through Europe, and its philosophers and scientists had announced the death of the age of superstition and the birth of the age of reason. The Industrial Revolution was creating social upheaval as engineering geniuses like George Stephenson and Isambard Kingdom Brunel constructed a technological future. Natural history museums in the style of Gothic churches were being constructed as new cathedrals to the modern sciences. Charles Darwin had recently published his theory of naturalistic evolution in On the Origin of Species, and Karl Marx was about to publish his materialist manifesto, Das Kapital. The advance of science, secularism, and technology was the backdrop to Arnold's haunting poem and its famous line about the melancholy, long withdrawing roar of the Sea of Faith. The receding tide of religious belief that Arnold witnessed in his day has only continued at an ever-increasing pace in the Western world. In the 1800s, the church and its Christian teachings still dominated society. 150 years later, we are undeniably living in a post-Christian world where the picture looks very different. In my own country of Great Britain, church going has declined steeply in the past several decades. The beginning of the 21st century saw a sharp turn against religious belief in popular culture, with the rise of new atheism, with over half the population now identifying as non-religious in a recent survey. A similar picture is emerging even in the church-going strongholds of the United States, as younger generations increasingly choose to label themselves as nuns when it comes to religious affiliation. As a Christian who believes in the supernatural claims of the Bible about the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus, I find myself in the minority in the 21st century Western world. Some believers have responded by circling the few remaining wagons and hoping things might change. Others seem to have given up on church altogether. However, in my personal and professional life, I've been keen to engage the secular culture around me rather than ignore or bemoan it. Hosting the long-standing radio discussion show and podcast Unbelievable, which has brought many Christians and non-Christians together for weekly dialogue, has allowed me to chair hundreds of debates between the most influential voices on both sides of the conversation on faith. My ringside seat has had the unanticipated but welcome effect of fortifying rather than weakening my faith. I've come to see the intellectual strength of the Christian story as it has been tested by atheists, agnostics, and people of other faiths who have appeared on the show, a journey you can read about in my first book, Unbelievable. Why, after 10 years of talking with atheists, I'm still a Christian. My vantage point has also meant being able to follow how the most prominent questions and debates have evolved in the years I've been hosting these discussions. Notably, in the past several years, the conversations have changed in tone and substance quite dramatically. The bombastic debates between militant atheists and Christian apologists have been far less frequent. In their place have come increasing numbers of secular guests who are far more open to the cultural and social value of Christianity, even if they're not believers themselves. Some of these thinkers and personalities are concerned by the turn in society towards a cancel culture of identity-based politics and often find themselves more in step with their Christian interlocutors on these issues than with some of their secular brethren. Most significantly, as the influence of New Atheism has waned, a variety of secular thinkers have been stepping forward to ask new questions about the value of religion and where the West is heading in the absence of the Christian story. Many of them have developed large platforms and have a huge influence on a younger generation searching for meaning. Many even seem to harbour a wistful desire for Christianity to be true. As their influence has grown, it has led me to wonder whether, even in the midst of our highly secular culture, we are witnessing a sea change in people's openness to faith. It was the journalist and author Douglas Murray who brought this home most powerfully during a conversation I hosted between him and New Testament historian N.T. Wright. Murray, an agnostic who describes himself as a Christian atheist, remarked that a number of highly intelligent friends and acquaintances of his had converted to Christianity in recent years. Perhaps they were an exception to the rule, or maybe something else was going on. Were people becoming more open to the Christian message? Were we seeing a new opportunity for the church to speak, as Murray put it, into a more receptive crowd? He went on to reference that well-worn line from Matthew Arnold's poem and said something which, although blindingly obvious at one level, had never struck me before. The interesting thing about the sea of faith is there's no reason why it can't come back in. The sea doesn't only withdraw, you know, it's the point of tides. In this book, I will make a bold proposition that Matthew Arnold's long-withdrawing sea of faith is beginning to reach its farthest limit, and that we may yet see the tide of faith come rushing back in again within our lifetime. The reason I feel confident enough to make this argument is that faith has never really gone away. As I will argue in the rest of this book, people need a story to live by. But the stories we have been telling ourselves in the last several decades have been growing increasingly thin and superficial. Meanwhile, a plethora of thinkers have been re-evaluating the Christian story and showing how it continues to undergird our most fundamental moral and cultural instincts. We may have forgotten the story, but it might be time to rediscover it afresh. I believe we are seeing the first fruits of the returning tide in the lives and stories of a number of public intellectuals who are finding themselves surprised by the continuing resonance of the Christian story. This includes people like the psychologist Jordan Peterson, the aforementioned journalist Douglas Murray, and the popular historian Tom Holland. You will find my exchanges with them and various other secular thinkers within this audiobook, along with the conversations I've shared with many other men and women who have crossed the line to Christian faith as adult converts. These include celebrated writers such as Francis Spufford and Paul Kingsnorth. The latter's faith journey was driven by his love of nature, but took detours via atheism, Buddhism, and Wicca before arriving at Christianity. There are academics such as classicist James Orr, who first discovered Jesus by reading the gospel accounts about him in their original Greek, or the equally surprising story of famed actor David Suchet, who encountered Christ by reading the letters of Paul as if they'd been written personally for him. And you'll read the stories of everyday secular people, such as Peter, Tamara, and Robbie, who had either rejected Christianity or never considered it to begin with. Yet they found themselves drawn towards a story that made sense of their deepest longings and desires. In sharing these stories, I hope to show why Christianity can still make surprisingly good sense to 21st century people, and how the church...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.